Hey, this is Kelly with Two Broads Talking Politics. Be sure to tune in on Tuesday, November 6th, that's right, Election Day, from 8 to 9 p.m. Central on Facebook Live or Twitter Live to catch our live podcast show. We're going to have election results, analysis, some special guests, and maybe a little bit of what are we going to do after the election? Hope to see you there.
Welcome back to Two Broads Talking Politics. As usual, I am one of your hosts, Sophie, and I'm here with my co-host, Kelly. Hey, Kelly.
Hey, Sophie.
Hope your voice is feeling better. Mine is feeling a little better.
My voice is better. You may hear my kids screaming in the background, but...
It happens. Joining us tonight is Melissa Dahman. She is a candidate for the Ohio State Board of Education from District 8, and she's also 18 years old. Welcome, Melissa.
Hi, thanks for having me.
Thanks for joining us. So usually we just start off by asking candidates to just kind of tell us a little bit about themselves. So just sort of tell us, who are you and how did you come to be running for the State Board of Education?
All right, yeah. So I'm Melissa Dahman and I'm 18 years old. I'm currently a college student at Walsh University in North Canton, Ohio. I grew up in a little town outside Youngstown, Ohio. As I grew up, I had a lot of influence from my siblings. They kind of gave me a lot of different volunteering experiences with everything that they did in their life. So I kind of got a feel for what I would want to do in my future. And after volunteering with children and tutoring, I knew that I wanted to help kids. I didn't know in what capacity that would be yet. I saw my sister go through her degree to get to be a teacher. So I kind of knew that teaching might not be for me necessarily, but I still wanted to be able to help kids. And this past year, around February of 2018, after the Parkland shooting, my school and my peers decided to look at our own safety within Canfield High School, which is where I went to high school. And we decided to look at how we can improve our building security and safety. And that eventually got us to Columbus, where we started to discuss different things with our representatives and senators on how we can improve schooling within Ohio. And I also had an internship with my local Democratic Party. And I got a call on my 18th birthday this past summer. And they asked me if I would be their candidate for the state school board. And I said, of course. So that's kind of how I got here. But it all pretty much started with realizing that there was a need for change within Ohio schools. And being a student, we kind of had that unique perspective of being in the classroom. And so we kind of ran with it. And we've just been really hoping to make change. And I think that this was the next step in my journey to help make change within Ohio.
So I think a lot of our listeners know about like local boards of education, but what does the State Board of Education do in Ohio?
Okay, so in Ohio, it looks over the Ohio Department of Education and the state superintendent, and a lot of the job is also going to be, personally, I will be going to the state house and hopefully sharing my insight with other state officials, but the board itself is made up of 19 members, and 11 of them are appointed by the governor, and then 8 of them are elected, so I would be one of the 8 elected officials on the state school board.
And so those are all by district then, right? It's 8 different districts in Ohio?
Right. Correct.
Well, what kinds of issues are you hearing about from voters as you're, you know, on the campaign trail talking to people? What sorts of things are they talking to you about?
Yes. Most of what I've been hearing is about changing the graduation requirements and just creating students some more diverse pathways, especially like after high school. So getting them prepared to not only be able to go to college, but also pushing more technical and career centers and maybe even apprenticeships and different ideas like that, instead of just making sure that every student can fit into the mold of becoming a college student to then get a college degree. And I certainly agree with creating more pathways for students, because I understand as being a former student that not like all students are completely different and we all have our own things that we're good at, and we should be able to work that into the graduation requirements where each student can focus on more of what they're good at instead of being forced to study the same things for every student.
What does the campaigning for the State Board of Education look like? You know, are you going knocking on doors? Are you going to events? What does that look like?
Yeah, so it's the last thing on the ballot. So a lot of people don't, there's not a whole lot of like coverage on it, and not a lot of people usually actually end up voting for it. It's one of those things that kind of gets overlooked. So mainly my main job right now is name recognition and making sure that people do recognize my name when they go to the polls. To be able to get my name recognized, we have been doing the maximum that I can do. We've been knocking doors. We just ordered yard signs so we can put them out at the polling places. We've been printing literature and passing it out. We've been throwing literature up on cars. We did a tour around the 13 counties of my district. So we drove 1,500 miles. 1,000 of them were in one weekend. And we just went around and we've been talking with different voters from my different counties. So we've really just been getting out there and trying to do as much as we possibly can. So as a college student, it gets pretty busy, but mm-hmm. it's been very enjoyable. And I loved getting to talk to the voters, especially in counties that I had not been to that often in my life. So being able to go and talk with them and see like the different parts of Ohio was definitely really cool.
So we mentioned that you're 18 years old. I believe you are officially the youngest candidate we've ever had on our show.
Not the youngest person, but the youngest candidate.
But the youngest candidate. And I think technically I am old enough to be your mother. And so I'm wondering if we can talk a little bit. You're also running, I know, against two other candidates who are much older than you. So I'm wondering if you can talk a little bit about what a younger candidate brings to the table and how your age is an asset.
Yes. So being young, obviously, I'm not going to know every single thing about education there is to know. But because I was a recent student of the public school system, I know what's happening now within the public school system and what faults there are within it. And so I'm hoping to bring that knowledge with me, and I can help explain to my elders on the board that these certain things are an issue and it's holding students back from getting the best education we can. So I really hope to bring the knowledge that they won't necessarily have to the board, and also just give them the perspective of a student, because the day and age that we're going up in now was a lot different from when they would have been in school. So just a lot of different hurdles that we have to jump over that they necessarily didn't. So being able to explain to them as we're voting on different issues what it's like to actually be in that position versus just judging off of what might be best for the teachers, but also having that student perspective up there as well.
It's kind of surprising that they don't have a student or a recent student board member just as a, you know, sort of position that's always there. You'd think that's something that would be of interest to them.
Right.
What do you think of running for office? Is it what you had expected it to be when they were asking you to run?
So when I got that phone call, I had about 2 to 3 hours to decide, just because the next day I had to get signatures in. So within those 2 to 3 hours, I called all my siblings and talked with them. And my brother had been on campaigns in the past, and he runs a nonprofit right now, so he has a lot of experience within politics. And I especially talked to him. I was like, I'm going to be going to school. Like, is this even feasible? Will I be able to keep my grades up? How will it affect me overall? And he's the one that pushed me to do it the most. And I'm so thankful he did, because it is a lot, and it is a lot more than I would have expected it to be. It's a lot more raising funds so that you can do everything that you need to do. But the main thing is that you have a good team behind you. At the beginning of this, I went to college, I think 2 weeks after I started campaigning. And at that point, I had a very, very small team. I think it was just my campaign manager and then my brother as my advisor. And I became very overwhelmed very fast. I was having endorsement calls in between classes and in between different events that I had to go to on a welcome weekend. And I very, very quickly got overwhelmed. But after about a week of constant turmoil within me, I decided that I needed to get a team. And asking for help is a hard thing for me to do, and especially asking for money is even harder. But having a good team behind you was a big step for me. And once I was able to get past it and ask for help, it's been a much, much smoother ride. And it's great to have a good team behind you, because they push you to do things that you didn't even think of doing. And so ever since then, I've really been able to go a lot farther than I would have ever imagined I would be able to as a college student right now. So yeah, that's pretty much the advice that I would give to anyone else running too. So make sure you have a good team behind you, because as long as you have a good team behind you, you can do anything, you can manage anything else that you might need to.
Many of our listeners are not 18. They are older people. And many of us noticed.
I'm an older person now.
I know. I think technically we're middle aged, Kelly. And I know that a lot of older people like me are sad when younger people aren't getting involved in government, aren't running for office, and aren't voting. So do you have any advice for our listeners about how to encourage younger people to get involved with government and politics?
So I would just say, honestly, setting a good example for children when they're younger. Voting was never an option in my family. It was always something that you did. It was a civic duty. You didn't. There was never a, oh, are you going to get to vote? It was when are you voting? So I think that's a big reason why, like, I always held voting with such high honor. So I think definitely at a younger age, like, getting kids involved with learning who their representatives are and their senators and their local candidates and making sure that they understand the importance of voting, even if you just take them to the polls with you. I was always going to the polls with my grandparents as a young kid. So just showing them that that side of society is a big thing when they're younger. And then even within schools, I would like to see a lot more government involvement within the schools. So like a lot more times where the senators will come in and like talk to students about the issues, where students can voice their opinions. I think that's a big thing as well. Just getting students acquainted with their representatives, whether they're local or statewide. Because me personally, I didn't get involved too much with politics. I helped like on campaigns as a volunteer, but not until like my senior year of high school did I actually have conversations with my representatives. And once you create like relationships with those people, it becomes a lot easier to understand government and to want to get involved and to help more people. And then another thing is like just be ready to hear the Generation Z voice. It can be pretty hard to like be able to accept other people's viewpoints. And I know that some of the older people might not be ready to hear what we have to say about schools and to be ready to hear what we have to say about feeling unsafe within our own school buildings. But if you're ready to hear our voice and accept our worries and help us overcome them and create solutions for the problems that we're facing right now, then I don't think we're going to have an issue. And I think we'll see a lot more kids get involved with politics if we can actually create solutions to the problems. But yeah, so that's the advice that I would give to you guys. Mm.
The good news is you have a lot more energy when you're 18 than you do when you're 40. So if we get the young people involved, they can do all the work that we're too tired to do. Are there other things that you want to make sure to talk about?
I can talk about mental health for a little bit as well. This past spring, after talking with my representatives and senators, we actually have a bill on the floor right now in front of the Ohio General Assembly. And it's Senate Bill 314, House Bill 713, and it revolves around mental health resources within schools. Recently, within my path, I've gone through a lot of mental health hurdles, and I know a lot of my peers that have worked on the bill with me have as well. And it's a really hard thing when you're in a school building every day and you can't find the help that you deserve as a student. And so one thing that we talked about with them was SEL learning, which is social-emotional learning at younger ages. So students can grow up feeling okay about talking about their feelings and just kind of eliminate the stigma that mental health carries with it. So students can feel okay going to counselors and saying, hey, I'm not feeling all that great, or hey, I'm a little depressed about something in my life that's happening, so that students can seek the help that they deserve. And then also it talks about increasing faculty members, like psychologists within the school building. And then it also talks about mental health screenings within schools so that students who are going through inner turmoil and don't know what to do, or that it's even whether they're experiencing anxiety or depression, they might not know that it's called anxiety depression. But if they were to be screened, then we could get them the help that they deserve. And it will allow them to talk to somebody about how they're feeling, and they can realize that it's something that they can talk to someone about, and they can get the help that they need for it. Not necessarily that this would be medicine, but just like counselor help. Because as I went through it, I didn't know what was happening. And then like once I got to high school, I realized what it was, and I was able to look up different ways that I can help myself through the school day. And looking back now, I should have totally had the resources, and I should have totally had someone realize what was happening. But I also never had that many relationships, like close relationships with teachers. They never knew what was happening. But so another part of it definitely is teacher and student relationships, as well as admin student relationships, so that when kids are feeling that way, if they don't feel comfortable necessarily going to their guidance counselor, they can go to that teacher that they're close with.
That's awesome. And how can our listeners help you in your campaign in the
the last few days before the election?
Yeah, so the last couple of days, the main thing is just going to be we need to get more literature that we can keep passing out at the polls. So if they're willing to donate, they can go to melissadauman.com, and there's a contribute button, and then there's also a lot more information about me on there too. And then if they don't want to donate their money, but they'd love to donate their time, we also have a volunteer form on the website. And if they live within my counties and they'd be willing to go out and stand at the polls and pass out my literature, that would also be greatly appreciated. So, yeah, those are the two main ways that we need help right now within the campaign. So, yeah.
And what does the district encompass in these which counties?
Yeah, so District 8 includes Athens, Belmont, Carroll, Columbiana, Harrison, Jefferson, Mahoning, Meigs, Monroe, Noble, Stark, and Vinton, and also Washington counties.
I'm related to like half of Mahoning and Columbiana counties, so y'all who are listening to this, you need to help her out.
And I know lots of voters in Stark County, so you should also be listening. All right, excellent. Well, we'll put a link to your website up on our website as well, and it's just really exciting that you're running, that you're taking this on at 18. I mean, it's exciting when anybody's running for office, but especially that you're doing this on top of being in college is really great.
Thank you. Yeah. Also, thank you for having me.
Joining us tonight is Hadia Afzal. She's a candidate for the DuPage County Board from District 4. Welcome, Hadia.
Hi, thanks for having me.
Thanks for joining us. Can you start off by introducing yourself to our listeners? Tell us who you are and how you came to be running for office right now.
Yeah, so I'm 19 years old, like you guys said, running for DuPage County Board in District 4. And I started running the summer after 2016. So I was an election judge because I was too young to vote, but still wanted to get involved. And so I saw how people felt disaffected by the power of their vote after Hillary won the popular vote but then lost the Electoral College. And after seeing that at a local level, we had only one Democrat win a seat of 18 board members by only 50 votes, I decided that I needed to get more involved at a local level. And so the next summer, 2017, I volunteered with the DuPage Democratic County Party, and I walked with them across the county, knocking on doors of every background, and asking people two questions. The first was, what county issues do you care about? And the second was, if they knew who they could speak to about it. And I found that people really shared a lot of similar concerns, similar worries, high taxes, good roads, good schools, but they didn't know who to contact. And so I started attending county board meetings myself. I saw, obviously, the lack of Democratic representation, but also demographic. We only have 4 women out of 18 board members and no people of color. We have no young people either. And so when names are being floated for who could run in my district at the end of the summer, I decided, why not me? Because I had spent the summer talking about the issues that mattered and I knew what voters wanted solved. And so I thought that if I could take that experience and my new perspective as a young college student to the board, why shouldn't I? And so that's how I got to where I am now.
And not just where you are now, but you've been endorsed now by everybody under the sun in Illinois politics. And you've been endorsed by Hillary Clinton, which is amazing.
Yeah.
And you've been on the cover of Teen Vogue. So there's that. Which is also awesome.
Thank you. Honestly, all this media, all these endorsements, they came after all the hard work we put in, because we spent our time, you know, hitting the ground hard, knocking doors of every background, like I said, talking to Democrats, Republicans, independents, undecided voters, and just asking them what issues were important to them and how we could fix it. And then talking to them about an issue-based campaign. And I think having that platform resonate with so many people was what drew attention to our campaign, regardless of my age or my background or the fact that I'm, you know, hijabi running in a traditionally conservative Christian area. I think our work was what made our campaign stand out.
So you talked a little bit about the area where you are. My husband grew up in DuPage County and has a DuPage County Democrat shirt that I think is older than you are. But what are the kinds of, you know, you talked a little bit about the makeup of the board, but what does the makeup of this district look like, you know, and what are people talking to you when you say issues based? What are the issues that they're really worried about?
So this county voted for Hillary Clinton by 14 points in 2016. But at a local level, like I mentioned before, we only have one Democrat. And so I think a lot of attention is focused at the federal level on, you know, Democrats, but we've failed to pay attention really to a local infrastructure. And then, you know, our county is 51% female. A quarter of the population is made up of people of color. We have a huge immigrant and refugee population in DuPage, and none of those voices are being accurately reflected right now in the makeup of the board. And so the priorities don't actually reflect those of real constituents in DuPage. And so our priorities, like I mentioned, focus primarily on fiscal responsibility. We pay very high taxes in DuPage, and they're not being used properly. And I think a lot of people are surprised to hear the words fiscal responsibility come out of the mouth of a Democrat. But, you know, times are changing. And I think that using our tax dollars responsibly isn't a partisan issue. Everyone should want them to be used properly. It just matters. We just differ on what we think they should use for. And so I want to see investment into actual constituent services, things for the people who live here, not just fattening the wallets of a few people at the very top. And that includes investing in public transit, making sure that we implement environmentally sustainable policies, making sure that we streamline government operations, address the opioid crisis in the suburbs, and really put our resources and our money where it matters the most. Making sure we don't pay lobbyist firms money to do our job for us in Springfield, making sure that we take a salary cut to put that money towards actual services, and then making sure that we completely overhaul the contract system, because we routinely grant no-bid contracts to vendors who also happen to be campaign donors. And so, you know, no one likes corruption. No one likes cronyism in the government. And so I think having that combined message of cleaning out DuPage County and also investing in services makes a very compelling argument for why we're a good campaign.
What has the experience of campaigning been like for you? I know you had mentioned that you wear a hijab and you're campaigning in a very sort of evangelical Christian area. I've been to Wheaton, and that's sort of what I think of when I think of Wheaton. So I'm wondering if you can talk a little bit about sort of what the experience has been and what the reception to your campaign has been in your district.
Yeah, so our district is actually more diverse than people realize. Yes, we have Wheaton, you know, most churches per capita in the U.S. and we have Glen Ellen, historically, you know, older, more conservative area. But we also have Glendale Heights and Carroll Stream and Lombard and, you know, majority minority communities who have never had the representation that they deserve. You know, we have a lot of Democrats, a lot of Muslims, a lot of immigrants living in those areas, and we've never had a representative for them. And so I think canvassing, like I said, our kind of nonpartisan message has been able to ring true to a lot of people, regardless of their background. And so I've been able to canvass and talk to people who've had a ton of Jesus statues in their front yards and get their votes. I've talked to Jeannie I, Peter Breen, Bruce Rauner supporters who have pledged to vote for us. And I've also spoken to Democrats who are like, you know, blue wave, straight ticket Democrats. And so our canvassing has been varied, and we've had very unique experiences for sure, but overall it's been very, very positive.
I was out canvassing in Kane County today and yesterday, so not too far from DuPage, and it seemed like the energy is just it's really picked up. It's really incredible that people, especially Democrats, are just so excited about this election. I know everyone we talk to is super positive. Has it seemed as time has gone on since you first started this to, you know, more recent canvassing, has it felt like the energy has shifted at all?
I definitely think that people have become more receptive to receiving political messaging at all. I mean, because we've been canvassing since like last January. And so people would open the doors and say, why are you walking for something that's happening in November? And so, you know, even before the primary, we were walking. And then right afterwards, this whole summer, people are like, isn't the election in November? Why are you at my door? But ever since then, people open the door and they're willing to have long conversations with us about whether they're planning on voting, who they're voting for, what they've done in the past, their motivations behind it. And people have really opened up in recent weeks. And I think that's been, honestly, just a treasure to see.
Even in the rain today.
Yeah. We actually got a ton of people because no one wants to be out in this terrible weather. But we were. So we were out walking in the rain and talked to a lot of people. So it's good.
So one part of your platform that I think is really interesting is your position on the age of tobacco purchasing.
Yeah.
You support a countywide ordinance to raise the age for buying tobacco from 18 to 21, which is surprising because normally you would think of younger candidates trying to get the age at which you can purchase things to be lowered. So I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about that part of your platform and why that's important to you.
Yeah. So this isn't a radical idea. It's been implemented in the city of Chicago where I commute to school. It's been in the city of Naperville, my hometown of Glen Ellyn also just put it through. And I opened my campaign last August, campaigning on this. And then 2 months later, the DuPage County Health Department endorsed the measure. And so this is a widely supported ordinance. It would help cut the youth. We've like cut the youth smoking rate in half in past years. And we want to make sure we keep that rate down. And we've seen a rise in, you know, the negative health effects of tobacco and nicotine. And we understand the harmful impact it can have. And I think that just making sure that we're in line with popular public health ordinances is the best thing the DuPage County Board can do. And so this isn't by any means a radical ordinance. It isn't a shocking proposal. And I just think it's honestly just a common sense thing that the DuPage County Board needs to put forward and actually push for, because it's in the best interest of every constituent.
So I assume there's not a whole lot of polling out there for local races like this. Do you have any sense for kind of what the election looks like going into Tuesday?
You know, you're right. There's not a lot of polling for a local race, but the Republicans have been polling. It hasn't been any of our competitors, but the Republican Party here is worried and they're asking people how they feel. And that just indicates that we have a very strong chance going into Tuesday. And I feel positive about the work we've done and all the effort we put in. And we'll see Tuesday evening if it's been enough, if our message of unity and responsibility and transparency has been enough to win over the people of DuPage.
So you're 19, and every election cycle, there is a whole bunch of hand-wringing from people my age and older about why don't younger people vote, and how can we get younger people to vote, and what can we do to increase younger people turnout? So I was wondering if you could tell us a little bit from your perspective what advice you would have for older people in terms of how we can encourage younger people to vote and sort of help them do that.
Mm-hmm. So I think making every election personal and emphasizing the fact that every person's vote matters when it means influencing and affecting policy decisions that'll impact our lives for a very long time, that is the number one way to motivate young people to vote. Whether it's talking about gun control and school shootings or climate change and, you know, the environment, these issues matter to young people. And I think we've been marginalized in the past. We've been treated as though we only care about things like net neutrality. Like, we care about, you know, we're just as multifaceted as any other voting bloc. And I think treating young people as that and understanding that they're complex people who have obstacles and barriers to voting, who maybe don't have motivation to vote because they've seen what's been happening the past 2 years. I think just understanding that and recognizing that and then combating it by pointing out personal ways that every policy decision affects that young person's future is the best way to motivate them to get to the voting booth.
So is there anything else people can do in this last day and a half before the election to help your campaign?
Yeah. So we're posting virtual phone banks online. So if you'd like to make some calls for us in the last few days, definitely please do so. If you're in District 4 or can get to our area, you can come canvass with us. And if not, then, you know, find your own swing district near you and canvass. Democrats need all the help they can get, and it comes down to these last few days, as I'm sure both of you know.
All right. Excellent. Thank you so much for talking with us after what I'm sure was a very long weekend of canvassing for you. And
absolutely.
I'm a bit in awe of the energy of 19-year-olds.
Thank you.
And we'll be rooting for you hard on Tuesday.
Thank you very much. I really appreciate it.
All right. Thank you.
Thanks for listening to Two Broads Talking Politics. Our theme song is called Are You Listening? Off of the album Elephant Shaped Trees by the band Immunuri, and we're using it with permission of the band. Our logo and other original artwork is by Matthew Wethlin and was created for use by this podcast.